So we are very happy to be able to release this new client portal at the last downtime. It really updates a core piece of infrastructure for us, and has taken the old infrastructure that we had had that was very, very dated and replaced it with something much more modern and capable. And one of the big benefits are the user visible tools. And so there's a lot more that you can do now as a user than you could before. In fact, before, the only thing you could really do at my.osc.edu is update your shell, your email, and change your password. And you can do all of that stuff now, but you can do a whole lot more. So let me switch over to the tool I want to show, or the thing I want to show, which is the web browser. So this is the client portal, the main login, right? So if you go to my.osc.edu, that's where you can begin to see all of the tools that we have. Now, if you already have OSC credentials, you can just log in with those here, the same credentials you would use to access the HPC systems. If you do not, you can actually sign up for an account directly now. So before, when you were new to OSC and maybe you were coming in as a postdoc or graduate student and working for an existing faculty member, they would have to email OSC help and ask for an account. Now you can sign up yourself under Sign Up Academic or Commercial if you're a commercial user, and go through a process that kind of verifies your email address, allows you to set a username and password, potentially request access to a project. So if you know the project code for the faculty member that you're working with, you can put that in there, and that will issue a request that will be approved by someone who administers that project for access. So it's entirely possible now to get accounts and join projects without OSC being in the middle, at least without our staff being in the middle. It's all automated at this point. So we can more quickly turn around accounts than we could in the past. So I'm going to go ahead and log in with my credentials. And obviously I'm an administrator, so I'm going to see a heck of a lot of stuff that you guys aren't normally going to see. So let me switch real quick to a normal principal investigator, and we'll go through everything as a principal investigator. Okay. So when you log in, you get delivered to the project dashboard first. And as you can see here, we provide some reporting to help show you what your usage looks like across the various clusters that OSC runs, the types of resources on those clusters, and your usage over time. So here you can see all of the usage has been by one project. And by default, this always shows a 30-day period, but you can choose the ending of the 30-day period. That is by default today. But you could look at a different month time frame if you wanted. You can see the total usage, in this case, 67,000 resource units. You can see where those were at, how many were on GPU nodes versus CPU nodes or big memory nodes. And then over the course of the month, how many RU were consumed per day across each of those clusters. And so you can see that, like, most of the work has been happening for this particular user on Owens. Unfortunately, there's a color issue here with Owens and Pitzer. We'll have to get that addressed. We're still squashing a few bucks. And if I wanted to change the period, I can just go here and get this kind of rich calendar thing. If I want to look at all of October and pull that up, and that's what we get. Okay. So next thing to talk about here, project summaries. So as you scroll down, this information, by the way, will look the same for a PI or a user. It just shows the projects you have access to and your usage across all of those projects. So this is across all of this particular PI's projects for the month of October. And this table down here shows, again, the usage across those projects, the status of the projects, et cetera, et cetera. And I can drill down and get usage details if I want, which kind of show me, hey, for this particular project, I can see who was using those resources, you know, roughly how much, and again, kind of which clusters they were across and resources on those clusters and so on. And of course, I can also see then home directory usage, so I can get an idea of how much space people are using, and we'll continue to add information here, like project storage. If you have a project allocation, it will show over time how much usage that you have on that allocation. So we're continually looking for ways to improve these reports. Unfortunately, that is popped up over the control. Ah, great. All right, hold on a moment. There we go. So we can drill down on any of these projects and get information about what the utilization looks like. We can also, let's see here. So we can also take a look at some other details about these projects, right? So if I click on this project link here, I can get details on the project. So I can see what the project code is, what the allocation type is, the field of science. Some of these are editable, depending on what your privileges are on the system and on the project. Some of them are not. I mentioned access codes. There's ways to set an access code. We'll maybe cycle back around to that. Also, review publications and funding that are tied to the project. Take a look at the users. And I'll dig into this in a little more detail later as well. But you can keep track of who's using the project and add and remove users as the PI. This is another function that used to have to be done by OSC staff, but now can be managed by the principal investigator themselves or by people who are escalated to having administrative privileges on the project. So it's possible to come in here, pick one of your users and say, hey, I want you to be able to administer this project on my behalf. And once you do that, that person would then be able to add or remove users, submit new allocation requests on behalf of the PI. So it allows the ability to delegate management of the project because I understand, you know, PIs are busy people and they don't always have time, especially if they have a lot of projects to kind of manage the fine-grained details of that. And they may want to delegate that to a staff member who does work for them or a postdoc or something. So all of those tools are available as well. And these pop-ups are always in the wrong spot. So there's a bunch of stuff here. I can drill down and see usage. So I can look at this is usage by day, by cluster type. And I can see job counts and RUUs and a running balance. I can also look at user usage. And so now I can see at an individual user level the jobs that people have been running. And this may take a moment to pop up. It kind of depends on how much usage, and this is a high usage project. So I can go in here, and similarly, I can set date ranges. I can look for specific jobs if I know the job ID. And here I can see, you know, who ran the job, when it started, what the job ID was. If I click on this, I actually can see the batch script related to the job. So I can see exactly what the user submitted. The job name, the project it was charged against, which resource it ran on. So Owens Cluster CPU, Owens Cluster GPU, there are other resource types as well. Core hours used, RUs used. Now, right now, these are easy to figure out because we have a formula that only converts core hours to RUs, but we may add additional charge types or we may charge differently for different resources in the future. So if we charge more for GPUs than for just core hours, the math may look a little different here. We can see the CPU count, the memory used, wall time used. You can also annotate these. So if you come in here as a user, you can add a note, and I'm not going to do this because this is someone's live project, but you can add a note, and you can send that note to the project administrator. Right. So if you're a user and you say, hey, something's wrong with this. I don't think we got charged properly or whatever. You can ask for the, one of the project admins to take a look at this. So actually notify them and send them the note that you type in here. Or you can notify an OSC admin. So this is one mechanism for saying, hey, this particular job had a problem. And you can pass that along to folks. Or if you just want this for your own information, when you export these things, and I'll show you a little bit more about reporting later, you can potentially pull these notes along with the records. And so it's a way to annotate some of the stuff that's going on. All right, so let's dig down into, I think, let me return to project details, see if there's anything else. No, we'll cycle back to the rest of this. So we can skip the admin menu, because that's something no one, none of you will see. We'll talk about each of the two menus, the items under them that we have here, project and individual. Project, now again, your list may look a little different, especially if you're not a principal investigator, you're gonna have fewer options here. Additionally, this account that I'm in is in the allocations committee, and so they have the ability to review some of the proposals that are in. So we'll not look at those options for this particular project or user. But what we can do here is we can immediately say, hey, I want to create a new academic project, right? I want a new charge code for a particular purpose, and I want to kick off that process here. So I can actually go in to new academic project here. I can put in my title, an abstract, the type of project I want, academic, or if I'm going to have a classroom, I want to use this in a class. I can pick classroom here. The allocation type you want, standard, major, discovery. We have lots of documentation on our website about what these mean. In field of science, right? And I'm not going to walk through the whole process again because this is a production version of the system. If I was in one of the test environments, I could probably do that without too much trouble, but I want to clutter up the database. And that's about it. You don't have to worry about this master service agreement number at this point. That may be something we have to worry about down the road. And once you submit this, it will pop up another part of the form, and this is all very well documented on our website explaining all of the bits, right? So the required documents that you have, how to request resources, there are some forms in there that where you say, this is how many RU I want, this is how much storage I want, this is, here's my CV, here's the actual proposal, here's the justification, the performance justification if necessary. The larger the allocation you're asking for, the more requirements there are for what needs to be submitted. And then this will go through the whole review process. So it'll get looked at by OSC staff, sent out for review if it's large enough, and eventually acted on by the committee. But we had the ability to apply online before, but now it's more tightly integrated with the same place that you go for your project management. I can, we're going to go ahead and leave this page. I'm going to go view projects. So this is a list of all the projects that I have the ability to see. Now, it's quite a few because I'm on the allocations committee as this user. So I can see more information about these projects than most people. If I had chosen a different PI, we would only be able to see my projects, the things that I have access to directly. And then I can drill into those and again, get the information about those that I want. Project access request is another one. So again, we're going to skip some of these allocation ones because they're not relevant. But project access request is one that I do want to show because everyone has this. So if you already have an OSC account and you want to request to be added to a particular project, and you know the charge code, you can go in here and type in the charge code, right? So if I want to be added to PAS 1234, I can type this in, hit save, and it will, again, it will go into a queue, an approval queue, and send an email to the project administrators on that project, which would be the PI and anyone else they've designated, saying, hey, I'm asking for access to this project. Do you approve or not? And if they approve it, then you're in. And it never has to go through OSC staff to manage this like it did in the past. And they can deny the request as well, and you'll get a notification that your access was denied or revoked or that it was granted. If you have been given an access password, and so basically the PIs or administrators on a project can generate a very long alphanumeric code that is set to expire at some point in time and hand that out to people. And so if you provide the project code and that access password, it actually doesn't then require approval. Basically, the access password is the proof that you have approval, because it is something that only the PI and admins would be able to see and hand out. Obviously, project codes can be determined fairly easily, but the project access codes, access passwords are not. So that bypasses the approval process. It's assumed that you're already approved. If you have that, you immediately get added to the project. So this is another nice advantage over what we had going before. So the individual menu, again, there's a little bit here that you might, like the service agreement, we can ignore at this point in time. But we'll talk about HPC job activity. I've shown this before. We're going to dig into it a little more detail here. So this is a report where I can look at any of my projects for whatever date range I want. We'll say all of October. And it will run a report to give me the jobs that were run over that time period. Excuse me. And those jobs, you know, as I mentioned, job script, job name, you can annotate, you get usage information, charge information, all that kind of stuff. But there's a lot more you can do with these reports. And many of the reports in this application have a lot more functionality. So I can change the number of rows that are visible, right? So there's 5,099 jobs that were run in the month of October on this particular project. I could show all of them if I wanted, or 5,000 at a time per page. Right now, by default, it's 10. So I only see 10 jobs at the moment. But if I want to look through more of them, I can. I can also sort and filter on the column headers, right? So if I want to, I can click on username, for example, and get a list of all of the usernames associated with these jobs. And I could filter just to a particular one. I could change the sort order. And I can actually group. Like control break is a way to group these by each item in that particular column. And so and this can be done on all of these. Additionally, there are some other actions. So I can go to columns and I can say, well, hey, there's a whole bunch of other columns available, right? Software lists, a whole bunch of details that we have that aren't shown on the report. I can pull those across as well. So if I want to see CPU time use versus wall time or core hours used, I can take a look at what my efficiency is, for example. So there's a lot of ways to kind of enrich this report, add and remove columns. Additionally, I can run filters. So if I click that filter button, it lets me build, you know, what column. And it doesn't have to be a shown column either. I can run filters on the hidden columns, various operators and expressions. So I can build out a much more detailed filter to kind of narrow down the list of results that I'm interested in. There's aggregations that can be done. So you can add up all of the RU used on a particular. So here's one example of a report we could build. Maybe I want to look at all Owens cluster CPU jobs. And I want to find out how many RU each user used in that category. I could build a filter and an aggregation that does that. And so I can do various computation or aggregations to say count up all the RUs used and group by username and only, you know, include a particular charge type. I can also do some formatting, rows per page, highlight rows, things like that. There are ways I can make it a little bit easier to read. I can generate charts. So if I build one of these aggregations, I could actually build a chart out of it right here in the application. There are group bys, you can do pivot tables. I'm not going to walk through all of these. You can actually then save this report. So if you build a report you like, you can save it, and it will show up here as an option, the default report or your custom report. So once you build a complicated report, you can save it and rerun it again without having to rebuild it manually. So it makes it a much easier way to kind of build repeatability into your reporting. And all of this reporting, you know, was only available via the command line before. You could get this data, but it was way less rich. You had way less information, and it was way less flexible, right? We didn't have any of these sorts of save reports or build charts or any of these other things. And you can download the data. So I can actually export a CSV. Once I build the report I want, I can export that CSV, pull it into Excel on my laptop or desktop, and then do more advanced things with it. So you have access to much greater amounts of data and much richer data management tools. So it's a lot easier to see what's going on with your work at OSC and identify areas where you're maybe using the system inefficiently, or identify users on a project that might need some assistance. And you can look at that stuff as a PI or a project administrator or a user, right? Users can see all the jobs on their project, except for users with a particular state, which is kind of a limited role. They can only see their own jobs. But there are ways for folks to run these kinds of reports and see more about what's going on. Okay. Let's talk a little bit about funding. So funding and publications are two things that are fairly new as well. And funding is very helpful for us to understand what resources you have coming in. And the reason that this is actually important to us is it helps us tell a story to the state administration or the university administrations about the value in OSC. You know, what are the research funds that maybe, maybe wouldn't be coming into the state or into your university without OSC? So it really kind of talks to the one of the values that OSC provides. So you can actually add your funding in here. And then when you submit proposals, pull in which funding is relevant to that proposal, right? So which, you know, this project is using funds by this, from this particular funding agency. You know, that funding agency is maybe supporting the grad students that are doing the research or whatever. And that can help us build a little bit of a richer understanding of how these things are interacting. The other thing to talk about is publications. And so you can also put all your publications in and tie those to projects as well. So we can say, here are the publications that came out of these projects. Again, this is very helpful for us to be able to talk about what are the outcomes, what are the things that were accomplished with these projects, so that we can report those out to institutions such as the state government or the universities about, hey, here are the things that are being done with OSC services. Here are the things that OSC services are enabling. So that's all very helpful to us as well. And these are relatively new tools, right? We've had ways to track these before, but it was very much, you have to tell us what they are manually and we have to input them. And by making this a lot easier, you know, we want to make it easier for folks to upload this data and share it with us, right? And I can add a publication. I'm not sure that this works. We've been talking about allowing people just to paste DOIs and have it automatically kind of pull that rest of that information in. I don't know if that works or not, but if it doesn't, that's something we want to add. So we're always looking for ways to improve the tool. We have some ongoing development work right now to fix some of the bugs that we're aware of post-deployment. And we have some money set aside in the current fiscal year to do additional development. So if there are additional features that we can add, either from a reporting perspective or a management perspective, we'd like to hear about things that you're interested in as a user, so that we can roll those in, right? So we have some ideas of some features we want to add, mostly around access and security, but you know, if you can tell us what's missing, if you can tell us what we need to add to make this more useful, that's incredibly helpful to us. We hope to add some features around software access in the near future. We have some of that work done, and we're hoping to add that. So So this is the portal kind of at a glance. I'm sure I've skipped over a few things. We have a bunch of documentation online. Let me see if I can find that. Here we go. So if we look at this, this is, if you go to the website, you go to resources, online portals. There is a link here for client portal. And we're still updating this documentation. It is fairly complete, but we are trying to add some additional things to and update some of these because we started building this documentation for the project that we've done. But you can go through here and see about your dashboard, how to change or reset your password, project menu, self-sign-up, individual menu, interactive reporting. Yeah, we talk about all these things except for maybe maintaining your profile. So let me do that real quick. Let's see if this will let me look at. Yes, good. So I am still the person I'm trying to impersonate. I can go here and update my contact information and submit that, change my shell, submit that. I can add publications and funding or view my projects here. And so these are all things, different ways to enter into the various tools and resources we have. And there's a mechanism here also to change my password. Right now, I can't change someone else's password, so this is coming to mind, but I can type in my old password, put in a new password, confirm password, the same kind of mechanism you would expect. Additionally, if I go ahead and log out, if I go back to the login screen here, if I have forgotten my password, there is a mechanism here where I can put in my username and hit submit. It will send me an email with a deep link to allow me to go through the process of resetting my password. So basically what I think we've created here is a tool that allows users a lot more self-management of their accounts and their projects at OSC. And as people become more comfortable with using the self-service tools, my hope is that will free our staff up to spend more time on the more complicated interactions that require a little bit more effort to solve, right? People who are having technical issues, if we spend more time working on technical issues, we can solve more of those technical issues more quickly than if we're spending time doing these administrative tasks. So my hope is that the self-service tools really give people a way to get more done more quickly. So I think I've covered everything I wanted to cover. It took me about half an hour, which is about what I expected.